Good morning. As someone said, it's nice to have a lovely Sunday. It's not too cold, it's not too hot, it's not raining, and the sun is shining. And the sun is shining. So good morning and welcome to all of you. We give a special welcome to anyone who is visiting. Please fill out the connection cards. I've got places that I'm looking at two different things, and they're in different size type, and my eyes are not adjusting properly, so I apologize for that. But we are glad to be together in the house of the Lord. Amen. The grace of the Messiah Jesus be with you all, and also with you. And we welcome those of you who are joining us online. We would ask that anybody in the sanctuary or online fill out. There's a connection pad in the sanctuary. There are friendship pads that may be in the pews.
Cards instead of pads.
Connection cards. Too many years of too many different names for the same thing. There's some kind of information so that you can let us know you've been here and we can pray for you, or we can give you a gift and we can contact you later, which we would love to do, but many friendly faces here and online, so we are glad to have you with us this morning. Now please join me in our call to worship, which is taken from Psalm 31. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. We praise you as King of Kings, for you have risen from death and ascended on high. And now, please join us in singing to our King of Kings, hymn number 151.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight, but downward bends his burning eye at mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of power a scepter sways, from pole to pole that wars may cease, absorbed in prayer and praise. No angel in no end, and round his pierced feet fair flowers of paradise extend, their fragrance ever sweet. Crown him the Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the rolling spheres, ineffably sublime. All hail smile throughout eternity.
You may be seated. The Bible says that if we say we have no sin, we are deceived and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, our God, who is faithful and just and merciful, will forgive us all of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So in humility and faith, let us confess our sins before God and one another using the unison prayer of confession. God of everlasting life, we confess that we continue in the ways of death. You are faithful in your promise, but we fail to keep your word. You offer us the gift of peace, but we remain captive in our fear. Forgive us, God of grace. Pour out your mercy upon us. Heal our troubled hearts, and lead us to walk in your light through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear now our silent confessions.
Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Friends, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ Jesus. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. And Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone and a new life has begun. So know that you are forgiven. Rise up and give glory to God. Having been forgiven by Christ, we must forgive each other and the world as we share Christ's peace.
Good morning. If you'd like to make your way back to your seats, if you've not already, a few announcements. Dot's birthday party is next Sunday. It's at Forest Road Park. There is a building at said park where the party is going to be between 12 and 4. It's like a drop-in kind of event, so you can go between 12 and 4 to drop in. If you've not signed the card for a year, Chris Adams has the card, so go see Chris at some point before you leave to sign that card for Dot. So that's what's going on with that. We also have new members class today happening in the dining room. So if you are not a member of the church and would like to know what it would mean to be a member, just swing on over to the dining room after church to check it out. By going to the class, you're not pledging membership. You are just going to learn what it's about. You can go and be like, I want to be a member, and that's fine. Go anyway. You never know. Maybe you'll love it. You will love it. Go over there. Also, we have got VBS going on. If you can volunteer in some way, please let me know. In fact, there's loads of ways you can volunteer around the church. We need people to volunteer in many areas. Sunday school, if you think you can teach Sunday school, once every month, please let me know. We really do need more Sunday school teachers to reach out to me for that. Deacons, elders, you know, if you think you might want to serve in some other capacities in the church, please be thinking about and praying about it and asking me or David what, you know, ways you can help that you're interested in if you are not involved in a specific area of the church, or maybe you want to just do more. Welcome, do more. What else we got going on? I think that's it in my bulletin. Anyone else got any announcements? All right, wonderful. I'm going to invite the children forward. The children's message. Oh, what would make you think these are bubbles? They do have a bubble wand, and you would be right, my friend. They are bubbles indeed. Enjoy. Some holy bubble. Yes, join us, anyone who'd like to frolic in the bubbles. So, I'm sure everyone has enjoyed the joy of blowing bubbles or experiencing bubbles. You know, it's funny how something so simple can make people so happy, right? Look at y'all, you're loving it. There's just some soap in a bottle. And, you know, it's not just kids either. You know, teenagers and adults also do really enjoy playing in bubbles too. You know, my son loves bubbles. We have all kinds of bubble devices at my house, so there's all kinds going on, but you know what, there's just one problem with the happiness that comes from blowing bubbles. It doesn't last. You know, the minute you reach out to touch the bubble, it bursts, or, you know, many times you might chase the bubbles, but they're just out of reach, and then they burst before you get there, or they are just gone as quickly as they came. You can keep blowing more, but eventually it will end, right? Because bubbles don't last very long. Yeah, they definitely won't be there the next day, that's for sure. So, you know, sometimes it can be really, you know, they can go as quickly as they come. And it's true for so many people today of how they think about happiness too. Exactly, they can burst by themselves too. Yeah, there's loads of ways they can burst. The point is they burst and they're gone. And My point is that the way we think about bubbles and happiness, you know, a lot of people, including yourselves and adults, think about happiness the same way. A lot of people kind of chase after happiness. But like the bubbles, happiness can sometimes just be out of reach. Or just when we think we have happiness, you know, our bubble may burst. You know, something may happen and we're not happy anymore. And, you know, Jesus knew that often people would look for happiness in the wrong places. He even said that we might be happier if we were poor, hungry, crying, and disliked by others. Why would Jesus say such a thing? That doesn't sound like happiness, does it? Well, you know what? He said that when we're poor, we can trust in God to supply everything we need instead of depending on our own money. When we're hungry for God and his righteousness, we realize that only he can satisfy our hunger. When we're crying, we can trust God to comfort us and ease our pain. And when we think we have no friends, you know, we have a friend in Jesus. And Jesus is the friend that will never, ever leave us. We all want to be happy, don't we? It's not fun being sad. So, you know, when we don't spend our time chasing these bubbles or whatever your bubble may be, church, whatever this happiness is that you think when I get there and when I get to this destination, I'll be happy. It doesn't exist. Just like bubbles, when we get there, we can feel happiness, but it can be fleeting. It can just last for a moment. But when you look to Jesus and God and your Heavenly Father, that is the true source of happiness that does not burst. It does not go away. It's not gone the next day. Yeah, exactly. So, remember, when it comes to happiness, the things that we experience in the world may make us happy in the moment, but when we want true, sustaining happiness that doesn't burst, doesn't pop, doesn't go away, we look to God for those things. Let's pray. Dear God, help us to remember that we can never find happiness by seeking the things that the world has to offer. True happiness can only be found in following you. Help us to remember that as we go through the coming weeks. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, good stuff. Hi, ladies, good morning. Isn't it nice to have sunshine for a change? Let's keep it going, all right. Our scripture today is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verses 1 to 11. Is it on the screen? Thank you, all right. Because it's coming up to Ascension, so you're hearing that. Ascension was several weeks after Easter, so we're still in the Easter season. But hear what Luke tells us. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This is what you heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has sent by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Amen. Let us pray together. Spirit of God, give us ears to hear, minds to understand, and hearts to obey your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I always am amazed that pulpits are always made for people like Pastor David and never for me. Anyways, height-wise. All right, we're going for a wild ride this morning. Okay, what international event happened yesterday? And I'm not talking about the Kentucky Derby. What happened yesterday? The coronation. Did any of you get to see it? Or you didn't care? All right, a bunch of you did. We all did. That's right. You notice that all the people who had ties to Britain watched it. Okay. Now, if you were paying attention, it was a Christian ceremony. Charles was anointed with holy oil from Israel by the Archbishop of Canterbury. And the choir was singing a hymn called Zadok the Priest, was written in 973 AD. That's a long time ago. You will also notice that Charles had several changes of clothes. He wore gold priestly robes at one point. Did anybody catch that? All right. Because you see, the King of England is called the Defender of the Faith. And he took an oath saying that he would honor the Church of England and all of that stuff. And now everybody who is part of the British Commonwealth, and I know several of you grew up in the British Commonwealth, are subjects of the king. Now, why am I mentioning all this? Because besides the fact that I want your attention, I'm mentioning it because the ascension of Jesus is his coronation to be the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So connect the two things together. Okay, now what does Christ mention for ascension first? Okay, we go back to the fact that Jesus promises the Holy Spirit. He's telling the folk to wait, and we know in a couple of weeks we will have Pentecost Sunday, in which we know that the Spirit of God has fallen upon people and they go out to proclaim good news. Now, there are several things we want to think about with Jesus now crowned Lord of all. The first is that he is the priest worshipped to cleanse us from sin. Now, one of my favorite writers is the late Scottish pastor, teacher of pastors, Thomas Torrance, and a few of you know who I'm talking about. He says that Jesus is now the royal priest. There remains before the God the Father, his face, the one perfect and sufficient offering for all humanity. Now, in the letter to the Hebrews, now remember, fasten your seatbelts because we're going all through the Bible this morning, okay? So check this out. Hebrews 9, how much more the blood of Christ will purify our consciences from sinful deeds, that we can worship the living God. By the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered himself to God as the perfect sacrifice for our sins. He is the one who mediates a new covenant, that's an agreement, between God and people. In fact, yesterday, when Charles took all of those oaths, you saw the Archbishop of Canterbury holding cards, and then Charles knelt on the Bible. What Charles was doing was renewing the covenant that a king, and then his mom, Elizabeth, kings and queens covenant agree that they will rule with justice and mercy over the people. And that's what Jesus has done. He covenants that he will be our faithful high priest. Keep that in mind. That's why we have a prayer of confession, to know that we are cleansed from our sins. But what happens when we have a bad day and we're not so following the Spirit talking to our consciences? We can say, there is no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. What about a good day? Because some of us say, hey God, aren't you lucky to have me as your person? And God says, I'm not interested. But what God does say in Jesus, your worst days are never so bad that you are beyond the reach of God's grace, and your best days are never so good that you are beyond the need of God's grace. We need God's grace every day, from the time we wake up in the morning till the time we go to bed. Every day is a gift from the Lord. Now, we know that in a couple of weeks, next week, Dot Davis is turning 100. There's a couple other folks we know in this congregation who are approaching 100. I was saying to Dot Davis when I was talking to her last year, she was born the same year as my mother. Okay. But we are not only saved by grace, but we live by grace. But something else. Jesus, our high priestly king, intercedes for us. Now, that's a big word we don't usually use too much. But to intercede means to speak on behalf of. So what we as Christians say is that Jesus, now enthroned as the high priest, intercedes for us to his Father. We can offer prayers to God and know that they will be heard and answered. There are days when we say, all right, Lord, you're not doing your job. You didn't answer the way I wanted. Have you ever had those days? Come on, be honest. Yes. I want to hear a big yes. All right, or an amen, that's good. But still, Jesus is in the business of interceding for us. He is interceding for us in knowing our needs, forgiving our sins, mediating for us in the presence of God. Every day there's meaning and significance to all we do and feel because the ascended Christ is there for us. And I'm quoting from another person I've admired in reading and writing named Donald McKim. Now, somebody in this room, somebody online, hello people online, needs to hear this. We need to hear that Jesus is there for us. Now, another thing that I want us to realize, again, that we've said before, Jesus is now the King and Lord of all. Now, yesterday, Charles went through all the oaths and everything else. I don't know if you caught, they had those four partitions of that throne. Apparently, that throne he was sitting on is like 500 years old or something like that. But Jesus is on his throne forever, and he intercedes for us. But besides interceding for us, Jesus, as our King, calls us to go forth to have other people experience him as the King and his kingdom. That's what we as Christians are called to do, to invite people to know Jesus as Lord, to know him and follow through on his mission and ministries. Now, for us, that will be very, very different for us. For some of us, it means to get involved in some of the icky, gooey societal issues, whether it's sanctity of life or speaking out against gun violence or whatever. Now, for us as a congregation, our particular ministry has been food. Now, of course, you know I'm Italian-American, so food is very important to me. But we have good people doing food ministries. For example, the Soups for Salvation. That's what, the second Monday night of the month, right, Joe? Joe Terzo. The 22nd. Joe Terzo heads up that ministry. And then we have our food distribution. Karen back there, Andrew and some of the other wild folks, everybody else who's involved. The third Saturday. Third Saturday. If you're not doing anything on a third Saturday, come here for 9 o'clock. We'll give you something to do. Giving out to 60, 70 groups, not just individuals, but groups of people. We have mission partners that we support in our church. For example, some of you know that our good friend George Harper is now singing in the heavenly choir, but we are still supporting his wife, Anne. They had served for so many years at the Asia Graduate School of Religion in the Philippines. We support Refugee Assistance Project.
We support El Centro in Plainfield. I was there yesterday. This is the ministry to help immigrants, mostly from Latin America, but from other places. We're involved with them. Other people, Pastor Lima in India, Reverend Nadia Ayub, who is now working in Greece with refugee children, mostly from the Ukraine. It goes on and on. And by the way, I heard that Pastor David and Lauren are kidnapping some of our young people to Pittsburgh for a mission trip, correct? Okay, that's at the end of June, I'm told. All right, it's voluntarily. Okay, right. Just wanted to make sure. Okay, be cool. All right. Now, to wrap all this stuff up, when we look at the ascension at the beginning of Acts, Jesus is now crowned Lord of all, and he invites us to his supper. So in a few moments, we will be partaking of his holy food, the Holy Communion. It's called different names in different traditions, communion, Eucharist, mysteries, whatever, the Lord's Supper, whatever your tradition is or no tradition, we are now invited to his supper. Let us pray together. We thank you, Lord, that you are Lord. We thank you that we are invited to be in your kingdom, citizens of your kingdom. You turn no one away. You just say, come and follow me. And we thank you, Lord. And in a few moments, as we celebrate your supper, may it be a time of blessing and joy and hope. In your name we pray, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
The risen Lord Jesus, let us now offer ourselves in service to his kingdom. Let us respond to the good word that Dr. Makary provided by offering the gifts of our lives and labor, the gifts of the Spirit inside us to each other and to the Lord as we sing a communion hymn. And please rise for that. Seated. After Jesus had died, and before the disciples knew that he was risen, the disciples were on their way back, a couple of them, to their hometown, Emmaus, and somebody came alongside them and was walking next to them. And he started explaining to them in their grief that everything that had happened in Jerusalem to their rabbi, their teacher, was all a part of God's plan. And their hearts were warmed inside them, but they didn't recognize who it was. When they got to where they were going and sat down at a table, the person took the bread and broke it, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. This is the table of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and he invites everyone who trusts in the mercy of his Father to share the feast that he has prepared. Please join me in our prayer of great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give you all the thanks and praise, for you raised up Christ Jesus to rule over all creation, giving him the name which is above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. We praise you, that lifted up in power, he lives and reigns forever in your glory, and so fulfills his promise to be with us always to the end of time. We remember that day when he made that promise to his disciples, O Lord, in Galilee, the last time he was with them. We remember their shock, for some their disbelief, that their Jesus was once again before them. We remember Thomas, who was told, Jesus appeared to us, saying, I won't believe it until I see him for myself and put my finger in his sides and the wounds of his hands. We look forward, Lord, to that day when Jesus will show himself to us just as he did to Thomas and the disciples. And we think of those, Lord, who are filled with doubt and disbelief. And we pray, Father, that you would appear to them, that you would knock on the doors of their hearts, that you would reveal yourself in mysterious ways to them, that they too might say, my Lord and my God, and trust in the ways that Jesus showed the world. Trust in the heavenly powers and principalities of justice and peace and mercy and love that are deep inside them and constantly calling them. We thank you, Lord, for creating this beautiful world, filling it with your glory, calling it good, for sustaining us with daily bread and the bread of life, Jesus, for calling a particular people, our brothers and sisters, the Jews, who have been a blessing where they have spread throughout this world, just as they were called to be through Abraham. We thank you, Lord, that you called us out of the darkness of pagan worship and idolatry into the light of the worship of the God of Israel in and through Jesus and the church. We thank you, Father, that we have gathered here this day to receive Jesus, to receive him in body and in spirit. We thank you for our brothers and sisters in Christ, for the blessings they give us, for the mercy that they show us. We thank you for our families and friends, and we lift up, Lord, widows and orphans. We thank you for our health, and we lift up the sick. We thank you for the prosperity you have given us and lift up the poor. And we ask now, Father, that as we break this bread and drink this cup, that you would pour out your Spirit upon us, that this bread might become for us the body of Christ Jesus, and that the cup that we share would become his blood, the cup of salvation. We take a moment now, Lord, to lift up to you particular places and friends and family members who are hurting and who need your help. And we ask that you send your Spirit upon them. Hear now our prayers lifted up to you in silence or with our voices raised. Sarah. Casey, Pete, and Lindsay. Amen. Hear our prayers. Amen. Be with those who have lost loved ones tragically. We pray for Betty, asking for strength. Amen. Hear our prayers, O Lord, for Mike. Amen. Be with all of our young people, Lord. Help them to know your calling and your plan for their lives. We ask all of this, Lord, in and through the risen Lord Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. And now we are bold to pray as Christ Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On Jesus' last night with his disciples, he was sharing the Passover feast with them. And he took the Passover bread, and he said to them, after giving thanks to God, This is my body, given for you. Every time you eat this, do it in remembrance of me. In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, and he said, This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you and for the whole world for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. Friends, every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. just wait, Lauren.
All right. Heavenly Father, thanks for communion. Thanks that we are your children. Thank you that we can go forth as your people of hope and joy. Amen. Hello there.
We can sing, Leo. We can sing.
Forth and incarnate the word and the sacrament wherever we go. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen.